And the first process is called filtration. So definition is from the glomerulus go to the Bowman's capsule. That's filtration. And this process is non-selective. It's not completely non-selective, so red blood cell won't be able to go there. It's they create a slit. They create a slit in this part. So if the molecule is smaller than the slit, it will go through. And if it's bigger than that, it won't be able to go through, like red blood cell will stay here. So it's not very selective, that's how I put it. And the blood, okay, that's in here, in the glomerulus, you have blood cell, you have plasma. And the slit is based on the capillary, and plus outside they put another layer called the podocyte cells. And these podocyte cells really decide the slit size. So if the molecule is too big, then the podocyte cell, like red blood cell, there's no way it can squeeze through. So red blood cell won't go into your urine. But the plasma, water, small molecules, salt, and glucose, it will go through the slit so it can be filtered in. And this explains the slit. So that's the capillary and that's the slit. Let's look at the slit. It basically has three layers. The first layer is the capillary. So the capillary is the single layer epithelium tissue. And that's the first layer. The second layer called the basal lamina, that's the basement membrane. And this has negative charge. So the basal lamina, the negative charge can help to keep protein in this site because protein has negative charge as well. And the third one is the podocyte cells. Podocyte cells really create the slit size. So the blood will stay here and small molecule like water, salt, and other molecule will move in. And sometimes you find people pee blood, and the reason is either due to infection, they damage the podocyte cells, or due to physical damage, like your kidney been punched, and you hit those podocyte cells. It's like you damage those slit, then red blood cell can go through. And when the red blood cell goes through, it will go through the whole tube and show up in your urine, because you have no way to take the red blood cell back through reabsorption. It's not supposed to be there. And what happens is you will go to your bladder and you pee blood. And you freak out because that's not normal. So that's the filtration slit. You have three layers, the capillary epithelium. And the second layer is the basal lamina, also called the basement membrane. Here's negative charge to prevent protein go there. And the third layer is those podocyte cells. And let's look at the driving force. The driving force is the hydrostatic pressure. When you keep sending blood through the efferent arterial to the glomerulus, this is like a balloon. And when you put water into the balloon, it creates a hydrostatic pressure. And that's the main driving force. So it pushes the blood from the glomerulus into the Bowman's capsule. And you have two other forces prevent the filtration to happen. And one is the osmotic pressure. Osmotic pressure is this. Because most protein, red blood cells stay in here, it won't be able to go in. So this creates the osmotic pressure. So water feel like they want to go back to dilute those protein, dilute those red blood cells. So this is against filtration. The third one is hydrostatic pressure. Every time you have liquid, you have hydrostatic pressure. And this pressure will push them back. So the net driving force when you take 50 millimeter mercury minus 30 minus 15 is about 10 millimeter mercury. It looks small, but this pressure provides a consistent pushing force to push the liquid from the glomerulus go into the Bowman's capsule. And this 10 millimeter mercury pressure creates consistent pushing force. So its filtration rate is about 125 ml per minute or 180 liter per day. That's a lot because you have about 5 liter of blood. And when we do the math, we found it's like every 30 minutes. actually less than 30 minutes, 25 minutes, your old blood in your body being cleaned. And now let's look at the filtration fraction. You have about 125 mL of blood go to the nephron per minute. But actually, the renal plasma flow, you have about 60 mL per minute. This is the blood will go to your kidney. So you only have 125 really go into the nephron, and you have 600 mL go to your kidney. So when we do the math, you found it's about 20% of your blood being cleaned. And these slides tell you the blood go to the glomerulus, 100% go there, only 20% being cleaned. And the other 80% will go to the efferent arterial, go to through the peritubular capillary. And those being cleaned, over 99% of them will be taken back. So eventually, your blood, over 99% be taken back. You create less than 1% of urine. So your kidney filter about 180 liters of blood a day, but actually you create less than 2 liters of urine per day, less than 1%. To regulate GFR, glomerular filtration rate, is important because you want this filter to last for forever. So you want the pressure, the filtration rate, to be constant. You don't want it to change all the time. But apparently your blood pressure change depends on your mood, your exercise, blood pressure change. So we can regulate the GFR by constrict or dilate the afferent arterial. Like this picture show you, if you dilate, if you dilate the afferent arterial, it turns out the pressure resistance decrease. When the resistance decrease, more blood will go to here, and what happens is GFR increase. So you can change the filtration by regulate the afferent arterial. You can also do the efferent arterial, but it's more powerful to do the afferent arterial. And if you constrict the afferent arterial, less blood will go here and the GFR will decrease. So when your blood pressure change, they can constrict or dilate this part to make sure the GFR is constant. So if they constrict it, they can decrease the GFR because the hydrostatic pressure decrease. And because of this autoregulation, your blood pressure, when we look at the blood pressure, if it stays between 80 to 180 millimeter mercury, and the GFR is constant. This is a big range. So for most of us in our whole life, our blood pressure stays within this range. Until it's too low and cannot maintain anymore. It happened to some people, they have the heart attack, and they survive, and turn out they damage the kidney. The reason is their blood pressure remained too low, and their autoregulation just won't be able to maintain the GFR to a normal range. And if your blood pressure is too high, it's also bad. But most of us, our blood pressure stay in this range. Because of the autoregulation, your GFR is very constant. And the GFR is well maintained. You want the filtration rate to be constant, so you can use this filter for forever. And you have the local control, systemic control. It's mainly due to the local control. And you have two local control. One is called myogenic response. This happens in the afferent arterial. The second one is called the tubular glomerular feedback. We'll mainly talk about these two. You also have the systemic regulation, but let's look at the local regulation first. The myogenic response is this blood vessel, like a rubber band, the afferent arterial. It will constrict more when you send the blood, more blood there. Then let's look at the tubular glomerular feedback. It's a feedback mechanism. So start from when you send more blood here, and more blood will be filtered in, become lumen, you have more lumen. It will go to the tube, distal tubule, and it will go to the ascending loop, go to this part. So the ascending loop, because of the structure, the loop is actually close to the afferent arterial. So in the ascending loop, you have a group of cells called macula densa cells. And once your flow increase, they will release a paracrine signal. And this pericardial signal is picked up by the neighbor, and the neighbor is this part, those efferent arterial granular cells, also called the JG cells, juxtaglomerular cells, JG cells. And these cells will release renin. And renin is a hormone, so this will cause vasoconstriction. So though it will cause the efferent because of the filtration increase, and those macula densa cell release the pericardial signal and being picked up by those efferent arterial, and those efferent arterial cells will cause the constriction and make less blood flow there. So eventually GFR is maintained. That's the tubular glomerular feedback, and that's the main mechanism to regulate your GFR. You also have systemic control, but usually your body leaves your kidney alone. And this happens when you have dramatic event happen in your body, like you have a car accident, you lose a lot of blood. And systemic is like sympathetic nervous system. The nervous system, sympathetic, will cause the arterial constrict because you want to conserve blood. And the hormone part is released the adrenotensin 2, that's a vasoconstrictor. We'll talk more about this in next chapter. So you have neuronal control, you have the hormone control. And why GFR is important? When you do the annual health check, you measure your GFR. And because we use it to represent your kidney function, your kidney is a filter, you filter your blood. So if your GFR is close to about 180 liter per day, and means your kidney is pretty good. And if you drop to be too low, means your kidney have problem. And we also use it to determine the renal threshold. That's the concentration, how much concentration of that molecule in your blood. So if your kidney function is not so good, you could not put too much molecule to make your kidney handle. And that's what happens in the diabetes patient, because their renal threshold of sugar is lower than normal. So they have to watch the carb they eat. And the filtration rate depends on your GFR multiply the plasma concentration of that molecule. So if you have nothing in the plasma, of course nothing will be filtered in. And when you have a lot of that molecule in your plasma, say you eat a lot of carbohydrate, and your blood sugar level, this is high, and multiplied GFR is a constant, of course more sugar will be filtered into your kidney, and your kidney need to work very hard to handle those sugar. So we use the GFR to calculate the filtration rate. Okay, that's it.